Hey everyone, in this video I'm going to give an overview of my new device, the nanoPi, and go over how and why I built it. So if you haven't already seen the demo video, go check that out now up here. So aside from just being a standalone synth, what else can this thing do? Well, you can actually plug in an external MIDI controller into it, you can use them in unison, you can use it as a drum machine, you can even charge your phone with it. So why did I build this? Well, I suppose I've always loved the idea of a synth that I can take with me and play wherever I go. That's what makes something like the OP1 so attractive, but it's also too expensive to justify the cost for my personal use. So that's why I decided to build my own version. So before we get started, I'm just going to give a brief overview of how the device works, what inputs and outputs it has. So the nanoPi features 25 velocity sensitive keys, it has audio in and outputs, it has two USB ports, as well as a USB port for charging, which could charge something like your phone or another device. Additionally, it can be used as a fully functioning MIDI controller for another computer. Right, enough rambling, let's get started on building it. So the first part of the design process was choosing all the components to use in this project. Initially, this project was inspired when I saw the Korg Nano Key, and I just knew that it would be perfect for this device. So that's how I started the process, building around that. So once I had that in mind, I had to decide what controller to use to make the sounds. So some of the options were a Teensy, Raspberry Pi, but that could either be a new Raspberry Pi, like a Raspberry Pi 4, or a Zero. So those were some of the main options. Just based on size alone, I pretty much eliminated some of the newer Raspberry Pis. So that either left me with the Raspberry Pi Zero or the Teensy. And once I'd looked at some demo videos of what other people had made, the Teensy seemed to be more limited and harder to program. So I went with the Raspberry Pi Zero. The rest of the components didn't require so much thought and planning. So basically there was the battery, a USB hub, and a USB audio interface. And that's all the parts to make this project. So the next part of the project was connecting all the components together, which in practice is relatively simple with the components selected. I could have chosen to solder them, but I decided for the sake of practicality, time, cost benefits, that it would just be easy to connect them by plugging them in. If you watched my demo video of this device, you may have seen that there was cables coming out of the device and going back in. Now the point of this is so that I can unplug elements of it and use them for other tasks. For example, I can unplug the device from the USB battery bank and use it as a charger for another device. The other option would be to unplug the MIDI keyboard and plug it into a computer and just use it as a regular MIDI keyboard. So that's why I chose not to solder internally the connections and instead run them outside of the device. So now, having planned the connections for all the components, it was time to move on to the physical layout of this device. The first step to this process was tearing down the Korg Nano Key to decide how much space I would have inside of it and how I could lay out the components inside of it. Basically, once I'd done this, I was able to just lay out all the components underneath the keyboard. Having laid out all the components on the back, it was pretty clear that they wouldn't fit inside the original form factor of the device, so I knew I'd have to extend it in some way. I planned this out by working around the battery, which was the thickest component and took up the most space. Having access to a 3D printer is really helpful with this sort of design process, and I was able to just quickly whip up a design in Fusion 360, print it out, and see how it worked. I won't go into full details on how I modeled this, but basically just take measurements of the keyboard and you model it around that. So it did take a few iterations to get this the right dimensions and fitting the case snugly. That's probably more due to impatience than anything else. So once I had a design that I was happy with, I basically just screwed it all together, used a little bit too much hot glue, and that was it. The build was done. So I haven't gone over the software setup in this video. Partly that's because with this build, you could now go and choose any of your own software that you want to use with it. But if you do want a setup that is exactly the same, I will be releasing a video on the software setup for headless fluidsynth controlled by my phone soon. Anyway, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please consider liking the video and subscribing to my channel for more similar content.